334 in your hymnal 334, to Jesus every day I find my heart is closer drawn. Let's all stand together as we sing 334, still sweeter every day. On that first together, to Jesus every day I find my heart is closer drawn. He's fairer than the glory of the gold and purple dawn. He's all my fancy pictures in his fairest dreams and more. Each day he grows so sweeter than he was the day before. The half cannot be fancied this side the golden shore. Oh, there he'll be so sweeter than he ever was before. His glory broke upon me when I saw him from afar. He's fairer than the lily, brighter than the morning star. He fills and satisfies my longing spirit o'er and o'er. Each day he grows so sweeter than he was the day before. The half cannot be fancied this side the golden shore. Oh, there he'll be still sweeter than he ever was before. My heart is sometimes heavy, but he comes with sweet relief. He folds me to his bosom when I droop with blighting grief. I love the Christ who all my burdens in his body bore. Each day he grows so sweeter than he was the day before. The half cannot be fancied this side the golden shore. Oh, there he'll be so sweeter than he ever was before.
Amen. Good singing. Good to see you in church tonight. And thank the Lord we have an air-conditioned building, amen? Amen. Maybe a little warm, but it's warm outside today, man. I don't know what it got to, but it 90-something. And but it sure is good to be inside, good to be in church, good to see each of you here this evening. Let's open with prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you for another Sunday night church service that we get to come to. Lord, we're grateful for what you did this morning in our morning hour and decisions that were made for you. And Father, we're back for more this evening. I pray you'll bless the music tonight and that we'll sing with grace in our hearts unto you. Lord, you'll bless our fellowship together, the giving of the tithe and offering. And then, Lord, honor again the teaching, the preaching of the Word of God. And use it, Lord, in each of our lives. Mold us, make us, and shape us to be more like Christ because we were in church this evening. May your will be done in our midst here tonight. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Turn with me, if you would, to 443-443. There is sunshine in my soul. Let's sing that first together. There is sunshine in my soul today, more glorious and bright than glows in any earthly skies, for Jesus is my light. Sunshine in the soul. There is music in my soul today, a carol to the King. And Jesus listening can hear the song I cannot sing. Oh, there's sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful, happy moments roll. Sunshine in the soul. Let's sing that last together. There is gladness in my soul today, and hope and praise and love for blessings which he gives me now, for joys laid up above. Oh, there's sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful happy moments roll, when Jesus
Remember, right after the service tonight, we'll have a meeting for those who want to have a part and help in Vacation Bible School. And we'll just meet in these rows right over here at the conclusion of the service tonight. So make your way there when the service is over this evening. And we'll have different areas that you can sign up for to help. June 11 through 14 is Vacation Bible School, coming up on us quickly. And then regular schedule this week, Wednesday night for the midweek service, right back here at 7 o'clock. And then don't forget, Saturday at 4 o'clock is our church picnic out at Windsor Park in Grove City. And sign up for that downstairs. Many of you have. If you haven't done that yet, sign up there and come on out and join us on Saturday. And we will have the volleyball set up. And, of course, there's tennis courts there and basketball hoop and a playground and all sorts of things to do. So you can come out a little bit early if you'd like. We'll have the volleyball set up by 3 o'clock or so. And you can come out and enjoy your church family there on Saturday for our July 4th picnic, all right? Now, next Sunday will be All-American Sunday, so our patriotic service. We'll have a great time, a salute to the armed forces in the morning service, and, of course, the pledges and all of that. It'll be a great, great time. Always a wonderful service, and be here to represent your state in which you were born, all right? We always have many states represented during that service, and sometimes some foreign countries, sometimes people from West Virginia slip in, and we have a foreign country represented, and we're looking forward to a great Lord's Day next Sunday, all right? And appreciate you praying for that service, and invite somebody to come with you next week, all right? Now, let's take a moment, and we'll welcome any visitors. Anybody here tonight for the very first time? Right here. Yes, sir. Tell us who you are and where you're from. Oh, sure. Oh, wonderful. Okay. Oh, all right. Wonderful. Wow. Okay. Well, Brother Wayne, thanks for stopping in. Thanks for stopping in and being in church tonight, all right? Do you work with what church in Walkertown? Gospel Light Baptist Church, Bobby Robertson. One amazing church. Was there many, many years ago, and just amazing. And praise the Lord. Thanks for stopping in tonight, brother. Glad you did that. Wonderful. All right. Anyone else? Okay. If you'll take just a moment and fill the card out for us, I appreciate you doing that. In a little bit, we have the offering. Just drop that in and keep the pen as our gift to you for coming. All right. Let's give this dear missionary a warm welcome, shall we?
Number 11 in your hymnal. Long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He is mine. Number 11 in your hymnal. We're going to sing both stanzas together. On that first together. Long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He exchanged a sinner for a sinless one. Jesus left his throne on high, came to earth to bleed and die. He said, Father, not my will, but thine be done. He is mine, he is mine. I am blessed beyond all measure, he is mine. Shed for me, safe forever I shall be. He is mine. Through God's mercy and his grace, he's prepared for us a place. Words cannot describe the matchless beauty there. We will praise the perfect Lamb, King of kings, the great I am. He has made the joys of heaven ours to share. He is mine, he is mine. I am blessed beyond all measure, he is mine. I have pardon. Through the blood he shed for me, safe forever I shall be. He is mine. Let's all stand and sing that chorus one more time. He is mine. He is mine. I am blessed beyond all measure. He is mine. I have pardon. Amen. That's great. Go to the back of the book, if you would, 539. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. I hope that's the case for you. 539, let's sing that verse together. Who can cheer the heart like Jesus? By his presence all divine, true and tender, pure and precious. Oh, how blessed to call him mine. All that thrills my soul is Jesus. He is more than life to me. And the fairest of 10,000 in my blessed Lord I see. Love of Christ so freely given, grace of God beyond degree, mercy higher than the heaven, deeper than the deepest sea. Oh, blessed Lord I see. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing the last stanzas together. Every need he is supplying, every need he is supplying, every good in him I see, on his strength divine relying, he is all in all to me. All that thrills my soul is Jesus, he has more than life to me. And the fairest of 10,000 in my blessed Lord I see. Let's sing that last together by the crystal flowing river with the ransomed I will sing. When we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out. We'll sing that a cappella. On that last, all together. By the crystal flowing river with the ransomed I will sing.
Seated. Ushers will come and get our offering tonight. Be prepared to give now as God has blessed and prospered you. And we'll ask God's blessing on our giving this evening. Brother Linderman, lead us in our prayer.
Let us pray. Father, again, we come before you, Lord, and just want to thank you for loving us the way you do, Father, taking care of us, Lord, meeting our needs, giving us a great country to live in, Father. We just want to thank you for that, Lord. And Lord, just want to thank you for one day we'll be in heaven, and it will be forever. What an amazing thought. We just want to thank you for that, Lord, and just want to give you all the praise tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Take your Bible this evening, if you would, for our scripture reading. Mark chapter 9, please. Mark chapter 9. Mark 9, if you would. We're going to read verses 33 through 40. Mark 9, verses 33 through 40, reading the verses responsively as we normally do. Begin together on 33, then I'll read 34 and alternate till we end on verse number 40. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 33 of Mark chapter 9. Ready? And he came to Capernaum, and being in the house, he asked them, "What was it that ye disputed among yourselves by the way?" But they held their peace. For by the way they had disputed among themselves who should be the greatest. And he sat down and called the 12, and saith unto them, "If any man desire to be first, the same shall be last of all and servant of all." And he took a child and set him in the midst of them. And when he had taken him in his arms, he said unto them, "Whosoever shall receive one of such children in my name receiveth me. And whosoever shall receive me receiveth not me, but him that sent me." And John answered him, saying, "Master, we saw one casting out devils in thy name, and he followeth not us. And we forbade him, because he followeth not us." But Jesus said, "Forbid him not, for there is no man which shall do a miracle in my name that can lightly speak evil of me." And let's read 40 together also. "For he that is not against us is on our part." And let's pray. Father, add your blessing now to the reading of the scripture here this evening. Thank you, Lord, for the wonderful music this evening. Thank you for the wonderful songs that we have to sing. Thank you, Lord, for being a great God to us and for providing a great salvation and a wonderful Savior in Jesus Christ. And Lord, I pray that you will prepare our hearts now and we'll be ready to receive the truth from your word tonight. And so, Lord, bless the special, please, to that end. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
When I think of how he came so far from glory, came and dwelt among the lowly, such as I, to suffer shame and such disgrace, on Mount Calvary take my place. It's then I ask myself this question: who am am I? Who am I that a king would bleed and die for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, thine for? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so, that to an old rugged cross he'd go. For who am I? When I'm reminded of his words, I'll leave thee never. Trust in me, I'll give to you a life forever. I wondered what I could have done to deserve God's only Son, to fight my battles till they're won. Who am I? Who am I that a king would plead and die for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, thine for? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so, that to an old rugged cross he'd go. For who am I? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so, that to an old rugged cross he'd go. For who am I?
Now, Father, as we come to the preaching of your word tonight, we pray that you will once again honor the preaching of your word. It still pleases you through the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. And Lord, I pray that you would help us tonight and open our understanding as we come to your word. Lord, help us to learn the lessons that you would like us to learn this evening. Father, help us to rightly divide the word of truth. And I pray your will be done in each one of our lives. Give me your help as I bring the message, and please help each one as they listen tonight. Lord, I pray that you'll speak to each and every heart and help us to be servants of you. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. I read a story a while ago about a man, I believe this was back in the 1950s, who he had served many years in prison. He had been a thief. He'd been an alcoholic and a very violent man. He served over 20 years in prison. And then he was released, and he went back to his hometown and tried to start over, tried to get a new life, so to speak. The problem was he couldn't get a job because of his past. Without a job, he didn't have any money to get a car or a place to live, and he was just in a bad place. In fact, he was contemplating what many do when they get in that situation, and that is, maybe I ought to just go back to prison. Had a place to live, got three meals a day, and didn't have to worry about where my next meal was coming from. And until at as desperation point, he encountered a farmer. And as the story goes, I was reading, he listened to the convict's, ex-convict's story, and the farmer offered him a job and a place to stay. He said, you come, and I'll give you a place to stay, and I'll give you room and board, but you have to work on the farm. You have to be able to milk the cows and bale the hay and feed the chickens and mend the fences and do other things that's required on the farm in order for you to live here. And if you don't do those things, you'll be homeless and hungry once again. And the man agreed, and he continued to live there and to provide labor for the farmer. And as I read that story, I thought, you know, that would be difficult for someone of this day and age to do. We have an entitlement society in these days. We would have people, if that was the arrangement that someone offered to them, they would have contacted the Department of Labor and a union representative and the ACLU and anyone else to try to say that that was unfair and that wasn't right. We have folks who kind of expect everything to be given to them. We live in that kind of a society. We have a government that wants to provide people with cell phones and a place to live and clothes and health care and everything, but the problem is many of the people don't want a job. I like the little thing I saw recently on not too long ago on Facebook, and you know, you always see these little things. I don't know how many are on social media. Any on social media? You see these little things come along, you know, you share this and money will come your way, or you do this and pass it on to five people and good things are going to happen to you, or something like that. And I like the one that shows a picture of a fella filling out a job application. It says, fill out one of these and money will be coming your way. I like that. That's true. And, you know, it's I'm not saying that there aren't times that people need help and people get in bad situations. I certainly understand that. But there's a difference between people saying, well, I really am in need of such and such, and people saying, I deserve such and such. We have a great, it grieves me, and it used to surprise me, it doesn't surprise me anymore, the millions of Americans that cast their vote for a socialist in this primary season. An out and out open socialist running in the United States of America. And he gets millions of support, largely, by the way, from people who say, he'll pay my college, he'll pay off my school loans, he'll pay everything. Well, he's not going to pay it. You got to understand where that money's coming from. But, you know, we have an entitlement society. You're awful quiet on midnight. I feel like you don't believe what I'm saying. We have an entitlement society. Now, listen carefully. The reason I say that is if we're not careful, that carries over into the church. And people think the church is all about them too. And church is all about them receiving what they want. And listen, nothing could be further from the truth. The church is not about you and the church is not about me. In fact, what happens is people come to church and they want to be noticed. They want to be recognized. They want to be in the spotlight. And they'll try to do whatever they can to make sure that they get in the spotlight. But here's the difficulty, is when that doesn't happen, when they don't get the recognition, when they don't get mentioned, when they don't get in the spotlight, when their name gets left out of the bulletin, or when they don't get compliments, well then look out. Trouble is coming, with a capital T, okay? And you don't want that. I listened recently to just a snippet of an interview with Tristan Thompson. Tristan Thompson was a forward for the Cleveland Cavaliers, and they were talking to him, of course, because they won the championship, and they were saying, what is it, do you ever get resentful because you do the dirty work? They call that the, because he said, you just rebound and play defense and try to block shots, and you do the dirty, and the other guys who score all the points, they get all the glory, and they get all the awards, and they get all the accolades. Tristan Thompson said this to a reporter. He says, well, he said, we all have a role to fill. I just fill my role. And if I fill my role and every one of us fill our roles, we'll be at our best. You know, it's times every now and then, Christians, listen, every now and then we as Christians need to be reminded of what our role is, what each of our role is in the work of God. And what the Lord reminded his disciples here in Mark chapter 9, as they were disputing, they had that kind of entitlement idea then, they were disputing among themselves who was the greatest. They're disputing which one of them, at one point, they even had the discussion, who's going to sit one on the right hand and one on the left hand of Jesus when he gets to heaven. I mean, you think about that. They were talking about who's getting recognized here. Who's going to be superior? And of course, Jesus could have said, he could have just rebuked them right there. He knew what they were talking about, but he wanted to hear them say it. And they didn't want to admit it. And so he taught them in verse 35, if any man desire to be the first, the same shall be last of all and servant of all. You have to be a servant. Now, the word servant in the Bible is a word that literally means a slave. All right? A bond slave. In some instances, it's the same word that's used as a deacon. But in any event, whether it's deacon or slave or bond slave, it's one who's been purchased to take care of the master. One who's been bought, and he's expected to be at the master's beck and call whenever he wants them. In other words, the sole purpose of the slave is to do as he's told to do. That's the servant. Now, it's pretty clear, isn't it? Jesus is the master, and we are his servants. Jesus is the master, and we are his servants. What? Know ye not that you're not your own? You've been bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. I was purchased on Calvary by the blood of Jesus Christ, and so were you. And I'm no longer my own, and you are no longer your own. We belong to Jesus Christ. I'm not my own to do as I want and do as I please and do as I feel. I have to do what the Lord tells me to do. So do you. We're simply servants. And as we said this morning, we are to serve Him. Just listen carefully. You don't have to go to all these scriptures, but you could certainly jot them down and just want to give you an idea here about what the Lord expects us to be. Jesus said in Matthew 4 and verse 10, when he rebuked Satan for tempting him in the wilderness, he said, get thee then, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Matthew 6:24, Jesus said, no man can serve two masters. He'll either hate the one and love the other, else he'll hold one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Luke 12:37, blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Luke 16:13, no man can serve two masters. Luke 22:26, but ye shall not be so, but he that is greatest among you, let him be as the younger, and he that is chief as he that doth serve. John 12:26, if any man serve me, let him follow me. Where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Acts 27:23. Paul says to those on the ship, there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve. Romans 1:9, God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son. Romans 7:6, now are we delivered from the law, that being dead wherein we were held, that we should serve in newness of spirit, not in oldness of the letter. Galatians 5:13, brethren, you've been called unto liberty, only use not your liberty for an occasion of the flesh, but by love serve one another. Colossians 3:24, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. 1 Thessalonians 1:9, they themselves show of us what manner of enemy we had unto you, how ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and the true God. 2 Timothy 1:3, I thank God whom I serve from my forefathers with pure conscience. Hebrews 9:14, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living and the true God. Hebrews 12:28, wherefore we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. And you go to the very last chapter of the Bible when we're no longer on earth, but we're in heaven with the Lord Jesus and with God the Father. The Bible says there'll be no more curse, but the throne of God and the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. All through the New Testament, you see over and over and over and over again, God emphasizes the fact we are servants of Jesus Christ, that we are to be serving him with our life. As I said earlier today, nobody's saved to sit, nobody's saved to soak. We're saved to serve. It's very clear. Now I wonder, has Jesus taught the apostles and the disciples this lesson? Did they get it? It's interesting. You can look through many of Paul's epistles, and he begins it usually always with Paul, a servant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ. But James 1:1 says, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Peter 1, verse 1, Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ. Jude 1:1, Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ. Revelation 1:1, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel and unto his servant John. It's amazing. James got it, and Peter got it, and John got it. The disciples seemed to grasp onto this, and when God had them pen their epistles to the churches or to the Christians, they all understood. We're just servants of Jesus Christ. Now I want you to turn in your Bibles with me to John chapter 3. Would you look there, please? John chapter 3. Verse 25, John chapter 3 and verse 25. The Bible says there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. And they came unto John and said unto him, Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, behold, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him. And John answered, said, a man can receive nothing except to be given him from heaven. It's an amazing thing that took place here. The rabbis come, the disputing a little bit, and really they're trying to get John to be a little jealous. They said, you know that one you baptized named Jesus? He's now baptizing people, and more people are going to him than are coming to you. Trying to get John a little jealous. What are you going to do about this new guy, Jesus? By the way, that's a game that sometimes is still played today among preachers and among churches. Well, how many did you baptize last year? How many did you baptize last year? Well, I baptized this many, or we baptized this many. And we tend to exalt those. And you know, here's the problem. If somebody baptized more than you, then they're obviously a compromiser and don't stand very much for the truth. If they baptize fewer than you, well, they're just sluggards and they're not very aggressive and they're not much for soul winning. That's kind of how it works. But that's not the way it ought to be. Notice what John said in that answer to this. When Jadeb confronted John, trying to evoke a response out of him, you notice what John said in verse 27? He answered and said, a man can receive nothing except to be given him from heaven. How about that? He said, hey, if God's blessing him that way, praise God. Thank the Lord for that. Among those born of women, there was never a greater than John the Baptist. He was great because he was a great servant to Jesus Christ. They took a poll in France on who would be the greatest Frenchman that ever lived. Everybody thought for sure to be Napoleon. But Napoleon did not win that poll. Louis Pasteur won that poll for his service to mankind. He's the one who chose to be a servant. And he was the greatest of all. And Jesus said, those of you who choose to be a servant, that's who's great. The world looks and says, no, the guy who has the corner office, the guy who has the windows, the guy who has the view, he's the greatest. The world looks and says, oh, the one who sits up in the top office of the big office building, that's the greatest guy. And Jesus looks and says, I think that fellow who comes in and goes to the basement and gets in the broom closet and gets out his broom and his cleaning tools and pushes a cart around, that fellow may be the greatest in the building because he's a servant to all. That's what's great in God's sight. We have to be reminded of ourselves what a servant really is. Let me give you tonight just briefly some characteristics of a servant. Can we do that? A servant, number one, loses himself in a cause. Loses himself or herself in a cause. What was a picture? Remember when David went out to see how his brothers were doing in the battle and he heard Goliath spew out his blasphemy against God and against Israel? And David said, "Who is this guy that he's going to talk that way about God?" Listen, David said a great statement in 1 Samuel 17, down around verse 46 or 47. He said, "Is there not a cause?" They were all trying to discourage him. They were all trying to criticize him. They were all talking against him. Nobody said, "Go get him, David." They tried to talk him out of it. Saul tried to put armor on him that didn't fit. They tried everything they could to say, "Man, you can't do this." David said, "Man, I'm doing it. Just give me my sling. I've got some stones. Let's go get him." Why? There's a cause. That's why. There's a cause that's bigger than me. There's a cause that's bigger than you. And there's a cause of Jesus Christ. And you and I tonight have a cause. We have the cause of Christ. And it's the greatest cause in all the world. Hey, people give their lives to hug a tree or give their lives to save a whale or give their lives to try to protect the environment. We're the people who say, "I'm going to give my life to serve Jesus Christ. That's my cause." We have a cause of the Great Commission to get the gospel to every creature. We have a cause to make God known, to know God and to make Him known to all mankind. Why have a vacation Bible school? Because there's a cause, that's why. Why do you have an All-American Sunday? Because there's a cause, that's why. Why do we go on a missions trip to Mexico? Because there's a cause, that's why. Why do you support 70 missionaries? Because there's a cause, that's why. Why do you have a country fair or a bus ministry or the soul winning? Why? Because there's a cause, my friend. We have to get the gospel to everyone. Lose yourself in a cause. There's a great revival taking place. In fact, it's down in your neck of the woods in North Carolina. They're just calling it the Burlington Revival. It started out in a church around the 8th of May. Just a church scheduling their spring revival. And guess what? God showed up. And by the way, only God can bring a revival. Man can't work that up. God has to bring it down. And the crowds begin to grow each night until it outgrew the church building. So many folks were coming, they couldn't fit everybody in the building. And it was a pretty good-sized church building. Probably not the size, I don't know what the auditorium seats at Walkertown. What does it seat, Brother Wayne? Your auditorium size, do you have any idea? A couple thousand, maybe? This was, I think, 800 or so auditorium. Pretty good size, but overflowing. So they had connections to Dr. Clarence Sexton at Crown College, and he had a big tent that would seat about 5,000. Do you understand how big a tent has to be to seat 5,000 people? I understand from what Brother Bob said earlier tonight, it's about, you picture about half of a football field to set up that tent. And they found a piece of property there, or maybe the church has enough property there, and they set that tent up, and they just kept right on going with the revival. They extended it past the first week to the second week, and the second week to the third week, and the third week to the fourth week. In case you don't know, tonight is June the 26th. They started May the 8th, and they're still going on with revival. Now they're averaging over 5,000 people every night coming out for revival. At one point, someone was watching, and they said they had like 107 different preachers there in the revival. I think they've had as many as 130-some in the revival. And folks from different churches joining in, and folks coming from out of state to come and see what it's about and see what God's doing. So what's going on? Hey, you know what? God's moving. That's what's going on. Praise the Lord. I'm so thankful that somebody has a cause. Hey, I guarantee you the folks involved in that, they're lost in a cause. You understand? They've been in church now every night since May 8th. You realize that's 31 days in May, that's 23 days, now 26 more, 49 days in a row they've gone to church. That doesn't happen unless you lose yourself in a cause. And servants lose themselves in a cause. Number two, servants do not care about having a title. Servants simply see a need and they desire to meet the need. Servants see a problem and they want to solve the problem. Servants have a message and they desire to proclaim the message. The world seems to be all about titles, but the Lord just wants servants. The Apostle Paul, when he spoke to the Ephesian elders in Acts chapter 20, there was no pride. There was no boasting. There was no bragging on his part. He said, "You know how I serve the Lord with all humility of mind." He humbly served the Lord. We're warned in the Bible not to think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. Don't think, listen, my friend, it's a tremendous, it is not only our responsibility to serve Jesus Christ, but it is a tremendous honor to serve Jesus Christ. And I got news, if you don't serve Jesus Christ, He will get someone else to serve Him and they'll take your spot. The work of God is bigger than any one of us. Don't ever get to thinking that you're irreplaceable. Don't get to thinking of yourself more highly than you ought to think. I tell you what, if I wasn't there to take care of that bill, well, that place will just go downhill. That's what will happen. No, God will have someone else step up to do that. God, it's bigger than any one person. Don't think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. Have some humility of mind. The natural mind is enmity against God. Paul called himself the least of all the apostles. Paul called himself sinners of whom I am chief. Simply put, he said, "By the grace of God, I am what I am. When I'm humbled, I cannot be put down. When I'm humbled, I cannot be put down. I cannot be humiliated, and I cannot be honored. I'm the same person no matter what the circumstances are." Don't get caught up in a title. When someone walks into this church and you introduce yourself, don't say, "Hi, I'm so-and-so, I'm a deacon here. Hi, I'm so-and-so, I sing in the choir here. Hi, I'm so-and-so, I teach Sunday school here." Then you're caught up in your title. And that seems to be a big deal to you. How about, "Hey, good to have you here, I'm so-and-so, I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. That's all I am." Servants lose themselves in a cause. Servants do not care about a title. Number three, servants will not quit. Servants will not quit. They never consider quitting because they're lost in their cause. They're lost in what they're doing. They never consider quitting because serving, listen, serving is not what I do. Serving is what I am. I'm a servant. There's a difference between I serve and being a servant. It's not what I do, it's what we are. And servants don't quit. God has to pry them loose from where they are. Let God decide when the work is done, not you. Your job description may change as you get older. You may not be able to do things you did when you were younger, but you can keep serving God. You can continue to do something for the Lord. You serve. Don't quit. You stay in the race. Finish your course with joy, like we talked about this morning. Servants lose themselves in a cause. Servants don't care about a title. Servants will not quit. Let me give you number four. A servant uses what they have. You know what God does? God equips us to serve Him. God doesn't... How many of you were in the service? One of the services. Put your hand up. Okay? When you joined the service, they didn't say, all right, now listen, you find a way to get a uniform, you find a way to get a gun, and you find a way, and then you're going to get out there and fight. They didn't do that. They gave you what you needed to fight the battle. They didn't send you out to try to do it on your own. They taught you how to use the weapons. They taught you they equipped you with what you needed to fight the battle. And when you say, I'm a servant of Jesus Christ, He saved me to serve, God says, well, I'm equipping you with what you need for the fight and for the battle. It's never about what you cannot do, or it's never about what you do not have. It is always about what you can do and what you do have. You know, there's a difference between a servant and a volunteer. You say, what's the difference between a servant and a volunteer? Listen carefully. A volunteer picks and chooses when and even whether he'll serve. A volunteer will pick and choose when and whether he'll serve. A servant serves no matter what. A volunteer serves when it's convenient, but a servant serves out of commitment. In other words, a servant does what he's told when he's told to do it. That's a servant. The volunteer does what he wants to do when he feels like doing it. Are you a servant or are you a volunteer? David Livingstone, the great missionary to Africa for 33 years. It is said when he came home, people tried to applaud him and heap accolades upon him as a superstar servant. But he said this, "For my own part, I've never ceased to rejoice that God has appointed me to such an office. People talk of the sacrifice I have made in spending so much of my life in Africa. Can that be called a sacrifice, which is simply paid back as a small part of a great debt owing to my God, which I can never repay? Is that a sacrifice which brings its own blessed reward in healthful activity, the consciousness of doing good, peace of mind, and a bright hope of a glorious destiny hereafter? Away with the word in such a view and with such a thought. It's emphatically no sacrifice. Say rather, it is a privilege. I never made a sacrifice." Wow. Paul, what are you? I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. Peter, what are you? I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. Jude, what are you? I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. John, what are you? I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. Bob, what are you? Xavier, what are you? Brian, what are you? Bob Reed, what are you? Servants of Jesus Christ. That's the greatest title of all. Let's be servants of Jesus Christ. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth this evening. Thank you, Lord, for the plainness of your word. Lord, I know things like this kind of go against our flesh. Our flesh likes to say things like, what am I, a servant? Yes. Lord, I don't just want a servant's heart. We just don't want to do the work of a servant. We want to be servants. We want to realize we've been bought with a price. We're here to glorify God in our body and in our spirit, which are God's. Lord, let us serve you. May we realize the great aim of life is to serve Jesus Christ. And I pray tonight that you've spoken to many hearts. We'll bow the knee before you and say, Lord, we are your servants. Do with us as you will. Let us not strive to be better than somebody. Let's not strive for recognition. For it is not about us, it is about the Master. Let us serve you with our lives. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed, and I'll finish the prayer in just a moment. But I wonder how many this evening would say, Preacher, the Lord has stopped at my seat tonight and He has spoken to my heart. And I desire to be a servant of Jesus Christ. I'm not striving for titles. I'm not striving for recognition. I just want to serve the Lord Jesus. I'm asking God tonight to make me a servant of His. Pastor, the Lord has dealt with my heart tonight. Would you pray for me? Would you slip your hand up tonight? Amen. Amen. That's good. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. God has dealt with your heart this evening. Why don't you respond to Him? Bow the knee and say, Lord, I'm yours. Do with me as you will. And maybe next time you meet somebody, and just say your name. Say, hi, I'm so-and-so. I'm just a servant of Jesus Christ. That's all. Remind yourself that's what we are. And let's serve Him. The Bible says, Jesus said, whoever serves Him, His Father will honor. The honor will come if you just be concerned about serving. That's all we have to do. Father, thank you for speaking to hearts. Have your way and your will now in each heart and life, please. I pray that we'd all be servants of Jesus Christ. Quietly with your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. Lord has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this evening. Will you please?
Oh, to Jesus I surrender. All to Him
right.
I freely give.
That's right.
I will ever love and trust Him. In His presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender. Humbly at His feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender. Make me Savior wholly Thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit. Truly know that Thou art mine. I surrender all. blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Look this way just a minute. You know, I talked this morning a little bit about Brother Johnston, and 25 churches he planted in 27 years that are all being pastored by nationals, self-supporting, over in Haiti and Dominican Republic. I sure can't help but think when he got the glory, the Lord said, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord." As I thought about that, and as you read about the men in the Bible, and you know, most of all of the apostles, except for John, met with a martyr's death. And they tried to kill John. And they couldn't, so they exiled him to Patmos, and that's where God gave him the revelation. But you know, you don't know anything. We don't know anything about them. What kind of house they live in? What kind of clothes did they wear? What model camel did they own? What kind of transportation did they use? What was in their 401k? Why do we read about them? Because they serve Jesus Christ. It's all that's going to matter in the end. The world makes it think all these other things are so big and all these other things matter. They don't matter. Oh, you got to have so much. Got to have $1 million saved up to retire. Really? See, the money is so important. And God says, "I tell you what I'll do. I'll use what you think is so great on earth, gold, and I'll pave my streets with it. You'll just walk on it when you get to heaven." That's how meaningless it really is. Only what you do for Christ is what matters. It's all that's going to matter in the end. Let's be servants of Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you for a wonderful day today in the house of God. Thank you, Lord, for the people of God in this place. And Lord, we ask you to help us now to finish our course with joy and not to let things take away our joy in serving you. We want to serve you. We are servants. And we sure would like to serve with joy. So, Father, help us to go from this place tonight being mindful of what you've spoken to our hearts about this day. We don't want to leave this place and be forgetful hearers. We want to leave this place and be doers of the Word. Help us to live the Bible that we know. And, Lord, use us to serve you this week. Use us to have the joy of the Lord be our strength. And for others to see the goodness and the grace of God in our lives. And I pray we'd point others to Christ this week. Use us to do your work this week, Lord, in the way you'd want it to be done. Dismiss us now with your care and with your blessing. Make us mindful that you go with us from this place. It's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's sing that together, shall we? Let me hear you sing. Hey, it's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You're dismissed. VBS meeting.